So, welcome to the webinar on network policy. Well, this webinar is coming not a day soon when there is a serious attempt to rewrite the national water policy, and a lot of activities are going on in that direction. So, it is quite important for us to know what is the policy as it is existing today, and what are the key issues that the policy actually needs to address in order to provide a long-term guideline to the country for the future of water security, energy security, and food security. This is very important from this angle that if you make some kind of statements in your policy, then it will happen that these very statements will be used by many other people to either support you, and more often than not, they can also provide a kind of a bottleneck because the policy is making a statement in a particular way. So from that angle, it is very, very important that the policy has to be understood in the manner that where we want to go and what is the overall consensus, which is based on the technical as well as the managerial and financial soundness. So from that way, many times it is told that what is policy? It's a document. We have been making this document since 1986 onwards. We had 1986, we had 2002, we had 2007, and then we have 2012 as well. The important thing is that whenever you make this policy, it doesn't become apparent at the time when you write that policy. But then, when you propose the schemes, when you come up with the developmental agenda, and that developmental agenda goes for financing, it goes for administrative support, then this document is taken out and it is read. And if it is found that this is not something which is in line with what we have been propounding in the policy, then you have a very tough time in getting that particular area through. So, this is very important for a large portion of the people who are here in this webinar, as I can see, are coming basically from the government and very largely from the central government. So, for us, it is so important to know that what we are going to do is something that is going to impact us for a long time to come. Policy is not a document which has to be fiddled with in a short-term manner. When you make a policy, that policy has to last for a long period of time. You can't have a policy and then you next day you again change a policy. Then the policy will not remain what it is, and it will actually go towards downgrading its importance, denigrating the people and the activities which have led to the development of a policy which cannot really sustain the tests of time. So from that angle, it is quite important for us to know that the policy is a very important document. Now, this presentation is actually getting delivered in an area which is interstate water resources disputes and dialogue for, settlement of the water disputes and water issues. Here again, it is very important to know that why the policy becomes so important. Because policy is the document based on which various contending schemes will be judged, and based on that, those judgments will then lead to resolution of the disputes. When you resolve a dispute, you would like to see that what is there in an overall national way and whether that national angle is being implemented in the areas which are prime domain of the individual states. Even though it is not a document which has got a legal validity, but it has got a substantial political validity. Because when we pass it through the National Water Resources Council, almost all of the state governments, are represented there, and all the state governments have to generally agree in order to get this policy adopted. So, in a way, policy becomes a base principle on which it is possible for us to work. Just kindly hold on. Yeah. You have to resolve the disputes, then those resolutions will have to come through in a manner that you are able to have it on a common platform of development, which is given by the policy. So, policy has the importance in the interstate water disputes in this manner. So, now let us get ahead with the presentation first, wherein we can discuss about what are the ingredients of the national water policy, and then how we go about and further work on this area. So, now, I hope the presentation is visible to all. Okay. So now, let us start the presentation. At the outset, the plan is that I will give you a brief introduction about the International Commission on Irrigation and Drainage, which is the organization in which presently I am the Secretary General, and then we will go and discuss in more detail about the policy. The international organizations have a very great value in policy. These organizations are a storehouse of information. Not only that, they provide you with an opportunity to look at the other countries and to understand what other countries are doing in the same direction. And this helps you a lot, because then you are able to provide supporting arguments from various other experiences, so that you are able to strengthen your argument, or you are able to dovetail your argument in an international dialogue, so that when you take some of these ideas forward, then the world does not really counter you in any other manner. This has become very important these days in case of the water especially. As you know, in case of water, there are multiple ideologies that are at work. There are so many issues that are being argued in different manner, in different contexts. And then the international organization is capable of providing you a support, which otherwise the other people or the other side of the arguments are not able to do so. And in that manner, you are able to support your argument, you are able to strengthen your arguments and move forward. So it is very much necessary for us to really know that what kind of international organizations are existing, and especially in the water resources field and in the areas of agriculture and water management, which is the largest consumer of water resources in any country across the world. The International Commission on Irrigation and Drainage plays a very, very important part, because that is the sole organization internationally which is exclusively devoting upon the areas of the agriculture water management, in which the maximum stake of the world is there for the fresh waters. The ICID was established in 1950, and this was an organization for which the India as a country made very conscious efforts and very serious efforts to bring in all about even 11 countries to be there and provide a platform for the development of education and training across the developing world. And this network of professionals has now spread across more than 100 countries, and it has facilitated the sharing of experiences, and it is dedicated to enhance the worldwide supply of food and fiber for all people and food security at various levels, because food security is the first step in the development of any nation. If you do not have food security, then any other amount of developments will always put you at a constraint, because through the mechanism of food, through the mechanism of energy, the country can be tailored around, country can be twisted, and country can be held to ransom at times. So food security is the first step that a country needs to ensure. And it also encourages the public and private partnership in development and management of water resources, which is a prime use for the society. Now, the organization has in 2017 adopted a vision and mission and an agenda 2030, which provides an opportunity to work across the world and go for the benefit of all, especially for water security, because this is our vision and mission, that where we say that a water secure world free of poverty and hunger through sustainable rural development. Because agriculture water management is primarily focused at the rural level, where the large part of the agriculture actually lies. And the goals we have set for the ICID are, like, one is to enable the higher crop productivity with less water and energy. So that goes towards the water use efficiency. Be a catalyst for change in policies and practices. So you are able to provide such directions, and you are able to provide such collective information to the world, so that others are able to tailor their policies and practices for enabling higher crop productivity and more production. Facilitate the exchange of information, knowledge and technology, which is quite important, because when you exchange the information and knowledge, then you have a possibility of providing new ideas, and that is how you become a catalyst for the change. Then you enable the cross-disciplinary and intersectoral engagement. As we know, water is a very important area which across the various sectors, it impacts the water, it impacts the development, and also it impacts the well-being of the various societies and groups. So cross-disciplinary and intersectoral engagement is very much necessary for water management, and agriculture is also no exception. Then it encourages research and support development of tools to extend innovation into field practices and facilitate capacity development, because not all countries are at same level of capacity. So this is the vision on which the ICID is working. This is the network of ICAE. There is some issue. I am not able to change the slides, so that is why it is taking some time. Is it now? Now it is visible again, I hope. Yeah. So this is the membership network. As you can see, we are spread across the entire world, and those areas are all very, very significant from the point of view of water security and food security. We have got a very good mix of developed and least developed countries. So all these countries are able to benefit from each other. Oh, Madhu, can you come? I'm not able to move my slides when I'm sharing. Okay. So these are the activities and initiatives that the ICID is taking, which is like international technical expertise in agriculture water management, international partnerships, collaborations, awards and recognition, where you can put in your water saving technologies through WaterSave Awards. You have got a World Heritage Irrigation Systems structures. You know, now it has started working. I don't know, it was not working then. No, but I mean, like, what happens is that It sometimes it is working, sometimes it is not working. I don't know what is the problem. So these are the activities and initiatives that are taken. Many of you may be aware. Many of you, if you are not aware, I would invite you to be part of these activities through your national committees, that is Indian National Committee of Irrigation and Drainage, which has recently been reconstituted and reset, bringing in more stakeholders across various states. And through that, you can participate in various areas, like you can also become participant of the knowledge creation and dissemination, in which there are a number of working groups in which you are able to participate, share your knowledge, learn from other people who are expert in that particular area, and create knowledge and disseminate knowledge. And then the capacity building, which goes through the trainings. So this is in brief, it was about the ICID, that what ICID is doing. And I feel that as far as the Central Water Commission officers are concerned, and also the officers from the various state governments who are there in the areas of water management, it is very important to take interest in the activities of ICID, because this is a unique opportunity to you. When that unique opportunity is presented right within your country, you have got the headquarters being here, you have got a great facility of developing close linkages with the institution, which will not only provide the benefit to you, but expose you to the wider world. People will start recognizing you, people will start looking at you and finding that whether you have got something worthwhile to say. And that helps you a lot in development of your knowledge and also in development of your career at times. So now, let us go to the National Water Policy 2012. Because this is the policy which is, as of now, it is existing today. And I believe that this is a policy which will actually help to see the further and further implementation, rather than getting into repeated policy development dialogues. The National Water Policy 2012 has been developed on the basis of various guiding principles. And it is to take cognizance of the existing situation, to propose a framework for the creation of the system of laws and institutions, and for a plan of action with a unified national perspective. This is so very important that this objective needs some amount of discussion. First and foremost is to take cognizance of the existing situation. What is it that has been obtained today? What do you have it today? Once you understand that what you have it today, then you also understand that what is it that you don't have it today and you would like to have. So you are able to envision the future, where you want to go and how do you want to go. We still have a long way to go in our water management exercise, especially at the national level. So taking cognizance of the existing situation is a very important part. That is the objective of national water bodies. And looking at the existing situation, propose framework for a creation of a system of laws, institutions, and plan of action. So these practices have to be put in life, and for doing that practices, just a moment, I will put my headphones so that if you have any voice breaks, I can. अच्छा वो आवाज ब्रेक हो रहा है.
हेलो हेलो हेलो, नाउ इट इज ओके. या. सो नाउ लेट अस गेट बैक टू द प्रेजेंटेशन. Let us get back to the presentation. That the objective is to take cognizance of the existing situation that we discussed, and now we were discussing the proposing the framework for creation of a system of laws and institutions for a plan of action. How we want to go about? What are the intervention measures that we will need in order to address the lacunae that we will find when you look at the existing situation? And those actions will have to be performed through a set of institutions, and those institutions will have to be provided with sufficient amount of necessary legal and administrative wherewithal in order to function and in order to provide. So the system of laws is necessary, institutions are necessary to implement the plan of action, and this entire thing has to be done with a unified national perspective. Now, this is the greatest challenge in a national water policy. Our country is very large. We have got very diverse kind of situations that are there. And in these diverse situations, water has been taken in and put in as a state subject. That means the states have got a preeminent domain on the say in the water management, compared to the union as a whole. Even though this is debatable, because our constitution framers were quite wise to that extent, and they made two things. They made the state list with entry 17, but then they also made entry 56, which provided for the interstate rivers and interstate waters. Unfortunately, while implementing, if you look at the state domain eminence, actually the state domain eminence is largely in the areas of water management in their own territories. For example, the irrigation, the flood protection, and so on. But when it comes to the overall distribution and settlement, it is the entry 56 which is more important. And that is where the important lies. But then, because of various historical reasons, which we don't want to really get into at this point of time, but the states assumed a very preeminent role, even in the as a part of their developmental exercises and started becoming and have started almost becoming like sovereign countries. While it is good for the local development, but then it is very much necessary for us to know that we are all connected with each other. Water is not something which can be divided so easily. So having a unified national perspective is an area which has to be addressed properly. And that is where the principles of NWP 2012 come in picture. So some of these guiding principles of national water policy are that water needs to be managed as a common pool community-owned resource held by the state under public trust doctrine to achieve food security, support livelihood, and ensure equitable and sustainable development for all. So, this is the basic gain. Any kulra? So now, other guiding principles of the national water policy are the safe water for drinking and sanitation should be considered as a preemptive needs. This has been there since 1986, in which we have been talking about the drinking water being the first priority for the national water policy and for the highest priority of allocation, because that is the basic area which is needed for your life. Then water quality and quantity are interlinked and need to be managed in an integrated manner consistent with broader environmental management approaches inter alia including the use of economic incentive and penalties to reduce pollution and wastage. Quality and quantity are interlinked. We are all continuously reusing the water. The hydrological cycle is nothing but the nature's way of reusing the same water in order to provide us with the sustained benefits year after year, centuries after centuries. But then the quantity and quality are interlinked. You may have adequate quantity and may not have quality. That may create another kind of problem of treatment. And you may be able to manage the quality and quantity in an integrated manner to have a regime in which you are able to provide the water of the acceptable quality to all those who are needing. And this has to be done in an integrated manner consistent with broader environmental management approaches, including the use of economic incentives and penalties. It is very much necessary in this society for the people to understand that if they do not behave in a proper manner, then there will be some price to pay. And this is where the use of economic incentives and penalties are involved. Water is essential for sustenance of ecosystem. Therefore, minimum ecological needs should be given due consideration. Now, this is a slightly debatable kind of an issue because there are various people who will argue with this in a different manner. But the issue is that when we are minimizing the utilization everywhere, then everybody should be able to should learn themselves to do with the minimum quantity that is required. Here, what we are looking at is ecosystem is also a same stakeholder, like you have the agriculture, you have the drinking water or other human and livestock needs, and you have the various other needs of water. They are all stakeholders in the entire system. The total quantum of water is one, and that is fixed. You have to apportion it at various areas. And then while apportioning, everybody has to say that what is the minimum that I need and how much I will be able to manage with. Because nobody can be allowed in a common pool resource. You cannot be allowed to create a lopsided distribution regime in which you will say, I will have only exclusively, I will use as much as I want in a particular way and to the detriment of everybody else. And that also applicable to the environment and ecological needs also. And they should be given due consideration. So this is the thinking. So the focal areas of the National Water Policy 2012 are, first and foremost is the water supply and sanitation. The provision of safe drinking water to rural and urban India with effective wastewater management. Safe drinking water is not only meant for the human beings, but also for the livestock. Livestock is a very important part of the rural economy, as well as with the rural livelihoods. And they also need good amount of water in order to survive. So water supply is not only meant for the, only for the human population, but also for the rural livestock needs, and also for other needs, like say, for example, even wildlife. At times in areas of drought and also in very hot areas, you may need to provide some water resources in such a manner that even the wildlife is also able to access the water. They don't really have a situation. I would request someone who has kept his mic on. Then the next issue is the demand management and water use efficiency. Managing demand is very much necessary. Demand management and water use efficiency, because the demands have to be managed. And if we are profligate in using anywhere, then that particular kind of demands will go much beyond the sustainability. So the demand management is an important part of the water policy, and their associated area of water use efficiency, that we need to use the water efficiently so that the minimum water is used for providing the maximum output or optimum output. The intrinsic balance of water supply and demand. We realize that even if we do all the demand management, there are large parts of the country which may still remain devoid of adequate water supply. So you have to strike a balance of water supply and demand. When we put in investments in the areas of demand management alone, we may deprive the supply side. And when we put the investments exclusively in the supply side, then the demand management may not be there and the equitability of the distribution may suffer, or we may end up wasting the water, which will be creating certain of its own ill effects. So striving towards a scientifically sound supply demand balance is the key area of National Water Policy 2012. And common integrated approach towards water management. If we look at it, we realize that we are all, in a way, we all live downstream of each other. Everybody lives downstream of somebody else. And one person's use or one community's use may become the input for the other community. So integrated approach towards water management is very much necessary, because we need to allocate the water so that the allocation is such that you are able to work with the same quantity of water in a manner that every needs are satisfied, and that development I would request all the participants to kindly keep them on mute. Kindly keep mute. There is a lot of disturbance that is coming from somewhere. Common integrated approach towards the water management, that is what we discussed. Then water governance. Water governance is a very tricky issue. On one side, water invokes a lot of passions, and every being a common pool resource, everybody tries to maximize the share of it. Everybody will say that I would like to have the maximum. And in such scenario, the governance becomes very important. If you do not have governance, you are unable to adjudicate between various competing usages and various competing communities, and the governance suffers, then the anarchy prevails, and that anarchy creates a, again there is an echo that is coming. I would request all the participants to kindly be on mute so that this issue do not happen. Then the environmental concerns. They are also important because tackling the uncertainties pertaining to climate change, disaster management and conservation of water bodies. Research and capacity building. We need to build capacities in a massive way. Many of the things are not intuitive. In case of water, many a times the intuition is that I would like to have this much water. But then from where it will come, how it will come, what are the vagaries through which it is going to be given to you, all these areas need understanding. It needs capacity building. We have seen this happening at number of occasions. Like if you take the case of, let's say, community-based works, many a times many of the decisions are taken which are not technically very sound. And in the process, you realize that even though the intentions were very noble, but the outcome was not the manner in which it was required to be there. The dam gets washed away in the first flood itself because somebody did not understand that there is a need for an energy dissipation. Even though it's a check dam, it will be subjected to same kind of forces. So this kind of capacity building is necessary for your providing the optimum solutions. And then the implementation, where the strategic frameworks for monitoring and evaluation and to ensure smooth and efficient implementation mechanisms. How do you implement the policy? You have to implement the policy in stages. You have to first draft a policy, then using that policy, one has to provide for a strategy. The strategy will say that these are the principles of policy, and in order to satisfy those principles of policy, how I am going to go for the implementation? What are the measures that I will take? What kind of measures that I would like to take, or the nation would like to take? And then those measures, in what priority those measures should be taken? Which measures should attract my first attention, and then which should attract second attention, and so on? And then comes the implementation plan or action plan, where one can then go into further quantifiable terms about which are the specific areas or specific places where specific kind of projects will be taken up. For those projects, what are the kind of typical finances that may be required? How those finances will be made available? How the communities will be mobilized in order to utilize those benefits that will be there? So all these areas become important in the implementation. In case of National Water Policy 2012, we had a very good policy document, but then we haven't progressed much on the roadmap side and then further on the action plan side. So now let us go. These are the kind of basic principles on which the water policy has to be based. The policy generally does not provide you with specific technical approaches. The specific technical approaches are actually left to the strategy or to the roadmap. Because if you start providing the specific solutions, then the policy becomes very rigid. And new developments that may come in future may not be really accounted for. So it is very much necessary for us to have a flexibility in which we are able to provide for the future developments and for the future areas to come in and give us better benefits. And that has to give for a flexible policy. In the strategy, there can be principles, and at the action plan level, there can be specific technologies, because at that point of time, we realize that now we will start talking in terms of money, and which is the, and I'm going to do it in the form of an investment plan. And at the time of investment plan, I clearly know that if I use option A, I'll need this much amount of money. If I use option B, I will need this much amount of money. And then you have got this full idea. So the specificity comes as you go down. If you go up at the policy level, then the specificity has to be relatively less. You do not have to say that you will only build concrete dams, or you will not say that you will only do the lined canals, because that will make things very, very rigid. Now, let us go into the various areas that the National Water Policy has endorsed and has implemented. One is the demand management and water use efficiency. This is one of the main paras in the water policy, where the demand management and water use efficiency has been discussed. There, the institutional arrangement for promotion, regulation, and mechanisms for efficient use of water at basin and sub-basin level. Now, these institutional arrangements are very much necessary for promotion, regulation. Over the historic periods of time, we have been cultivating crops. And with the past, because in the past, our level of cultivations or our intensity of agriculture, which was to cater to the population size that was there at that point of time, was in a slightly different manner. We had less amount of technologies, but we had enough amount of water for the restricted type of agriculture that we used to practice, because the demands or the population size was not really that great. But then over the period of time, these have changed. When we started with something like 30 crores of population for the country, and now today we are at 1300. 130 crores. So the factor at which the demands have gone up are different, but at the same factor, we haven't been able to increase the water. Water is a finite resource. Water in average will be available only around a fixed quantity. It will fluctuate around that quantity. Sometimes you will have more, sometimes you will have less. Land is absolutely fixed. It is no more possible for us to have extra land. Land that has been there under traditional cultivation is fixed. Now, if you have to get extra land, you may have to encroach upon the other parts of our environmental sustainability. Because if you get into the forests, and if you get into those areas which are used for other purposes, for your agricultural use, then you may create harm to the environment, you may create harm to the ecology, and you may also create harm to the wildlife and various other areas. So the land is highly fixed, the water is highly fixed, but the demands have grown. So it becomes important that we need to have institutional arrangements for promotion, regulation, and then the mechanism for the efficient use. If you increase the efficiency, same quantum of water will be possible for you to go ahead and provide for larger areas. Now, how do you do that? The There are various measures that are possible, like evolving the benchmarks for using the project and basin level water use efficiencies with continuous water accounting, water use patterns for monitoring purposes. So these things we need in order to set up the mechanisms. And then the institutional arrangements like the river basin organizations and various other implementing organizations at the community level, you have got the water user associations kind of organizations who can also look at this area. Then the structured financing to incentivize efficient and economic use of water and in timely completion of projects. Ultimately, it all results into money. If your financing is unpredictable, then two unpredictables will go together. The water availability is unpredictable, and your measures to harness it are also going to be unpredictable because of the financing. Then your outputs will always be highly suboptimal. So structured financing is very much necessary for timely completion of projects. This is something which has actually prompted us to go for the schemes like AIBP and now the recent scheme of PMKSY, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana, wherein the financing is assessed, demands are assessed, and then those demands are tried to be provided for in time so that you have timely completion of projects, even though this is a very big challenge. Timely completion of projects, especially of water resources, is probably the greatest challenge, and it is not something which is restricted to India, but even in other parts of the country also, there are issues on this. So the timely completion of project is a big aim to be achieved. Then aligning cropping pattern with the natural resource endowments, another very big challenge. What kind of natural resource endowments you have, how much in an ultimate limit you will be able to mobilize towards the areas of, let us say, land, and also towards the areas of agriculture practices and investments, and the water being the another very key source which will also be one of the legs of this entire cropping pattern. And if we do not align this, then we are having a very lopsided situation. We have witnessed it across the parts of the country. The continuously going down of the groundwaters is one of the examples which is there. So this is a very big challenge, but then it has got very large impact on the overall water availability, because 70% of the water is used at the agriculture level. And if our agriculture practices are not in consonance with the water resources availability, then this will create patterns which may be damaging, like the excessive depletion of groundwater. There will also be economic distress. If the cropping pattern is not in alignment, the crop failures will be larger, and that may lead to a very difficult social situation. So this alignment is a very big challenge that we need to really look at. And then there are various technologies that have become available world over, which we need to look at and which we need to implement in order to see that how we can minimize the use of water. So the micro irrigation and other measures of water saving in agriculture, these measures also need to be promoted through a policy-based approach. Then the other area is managing the supply side of balance. However much we manage the demands, it has been realized that there is an upper limit to which you can provide in the given state of technology and in the given state of agricultural practices and the knowledge base. After doing all this also, we will still be left with the areas which will not be provided with the water in an adequate manner, even though in an optimum manner, even after then we have done all the possible demand management. So managing the supply side of the balance is equally important. You have to manage the supply side of balance. If you do not generate the supplies, then eventually whatever water, whatever little you have, will get fully utilized, and then there will be people who will question you on this front, that historically if some area has been fortunate in receiving a particular kind of water supply and able to prosper, then what is the fault of the other area which has not been able to be provided for? In a democracy, every person has to be an equal. Every area has to have an equal opportunity. Democracy means equal opportunity to all. If we do not, if we constrain ourselves only looking at the purely at the demand side supplies, then such areas who are not having the adequate supplies, even after making all kinds of efficient manners, then those areas will feel deprived. So supply side intervention is equally important as much as the demand side intervention. So supply side, now when we look at our supply side area, we find that out of 450 BCM of surface water that we are able to use, or we can say considering as our utilizable resources, we have actually created storages and used it at around 250 BCM. That means a large part is still, though available, is not being utilized. Various reasons are there. We don't go into the reasons because that will divert us. But the area is, the policy has to look at the situation where we would like to say that if you have a resource available and you don't use it and you deprive somebody, then that is not a socially or economically or a politically agreeable kind of a situation. So we need to work on the supply side augmentation. Now, water is a random resource. When you talk about 450 BCM, 250 BCM, 1123 BCM, all these things, what we are talking is average. You have almost equal probability of falling below that as much as you have a probability of going above that. It is not known whether it will happen in consecutive years, or it will happen in over a cycle of several years. Like Australia experienced a drought for almost 10 years, 20 years. We also have seen situations in our own country, in our own specific areas, where there are consecutive droughts. And then there are consecutive surplus areas also. So this, whereas when you look at the demand side, the demand remains constant. Rather, the demand goes up when the supply goes down. As the temperatures go up, as the desiccation grows up, your evapotranspiration losses go up, and evapotranspiration loss utilization that is required by the plant also go up with the temperatures. You need more water. And when the temperatures go up, you have less water because that is the dry season. So balancing out this, and this balancing has to be done over longer cycles of the multiple cycles of the hydrological cycle. So the climate resilience basically means that you require balancing storages. Without storage in a monsoon fed country like ours, it has been repeatedly shown that it is not possible to manage water. We do not have a situation in which your rainfall varies about around certain percentage. We have 100% variation. We have got in 90 days, you have got all the almost 90% of the 70, 80, 90% of the rainfall, and then rest of the period rainfall is there, but that is in an average. There are large number of years in which those lean season rainfalls will never occur. You will have a continuous dry seasons. There's no guarantee. So this resilience has to be brought in, and that is where the supply side interventions of balancing storages and dynamic water transfers come across. Operation and management policies in financing that they require constant attention. These are all engineering structures. These are all man-made structures, even though sometimes some of our colleagues have got a what you can say, some amount of dislike for the engineers. There is a strong lobby which will say that engineers are the root cause of all evil, because they are the ones who make something and then we all feel that it was all wrong. So, but they do require constant attention because they are all man-made structures. And management policies also have to keep on changing with the changing aspirations of the people, changing socio-economic and land use conditions. So they require constant attention. That is where the managing the supply side of the balance also comes in. Then there are various other areas like asset inventorization and management principles need to be brought in. Specialized disciplines like dam safety have to be brought in in order to maintain your supply side of balance. It is not good to simply create. It is also equally important to manage what you have created. As a culture, at times we feel that we have a lot of desire of creating. We have a lot of creativity as a country. But then when it comes to the maintenance and management of that particular area, we fall short of it. We are a country who have got Taj Mahal, one of the wonders of the world. But then what engineering drawings or what engineering information that has been conveyed or that has been conserved from its original construction? Nil. Almost at the same time, these areas that were precision surveying and precision works that were being done in those days, almost around the similar times, Newton was developing his theories. They were being applied in the practice. An industrial revolution was gathering steam. And for that, a lot of documentation was happening. A lot of inventorization of those developments were happening, whereas we do not. So the asset inventorization is a cultural trait that the country has to bring in. And that is where the policy also has to really look at and provide that we need to have this kind of principles should be brought in our development paradigms. So this project planning and implementation is a section that has been provided in the water policy where these areas have been discussed, that what kind of project planning is required, how the integrated water resources management is to be applied to find the reasonable and acceptable solutions for the stakeholders. Project execution in a pari passu manner so that the intended benefits start accruing immediately and there is no gap between potential created and potential utilized. This is also a very big word, and there are a lot of areas that we have. Developing hydropower projects with storage provision to derive maximum benefit from available topology and water resources. Even though the renewables have been receiving a lot of focus and a lot of attention, hydropower, which is one of the imminent sources of renewable energy, has been given a kind of a short shrift so far. And somehow, there's a lobby that kind of got developed on this area, that the hydropower is something which is kind of damaging and they have to be kind of discouraged. But then the fact is that if you really want to have cheap power with minimum maintenance and over indefinite periods of time in the future, then you only have hydropower. So balancing your grid can be done only at the hydropower project level. So development of hydropower projects is something that is very, very important. Concurrent monitoring at the project, state and central level for timely interventions to avoid time and cost overruns. This is a big issue. Almost everybody who has worked with the project monitoring or project management or designs would realize that this, for the timely intervention and avoiding time and cost overruns, to what extent it gives you the benefits. And these two have to come together, balancing the demand supply equation. The demands are dynamic and fluctuate rapidly from one hydrological cycle to another. Sometimes you will have no demand for your water because the so much amount of rainfall has taken place in command area. And next year you will have all the demands and you will have hardly got any supplies. So these have to be matched. And for that, supply side interventions come in the picture. But then supply side interventions take long time to implement. Whatever you do, projects have a life cycle. Very rarely a major project can be completed in a very short period of time. It is not that when you decide that you want to have the project and the next day the project will be there, even though the demand will be there, demand will precede your even planning. That is why you will actually start planning. So the supply interventions have to be balanced with the demand, and whatever supply interventions you have, you have to balance it with the available demands. Calibrating growths in demands with the available limits of supply. When you have a policy, then we have to achieve this balance. That how do you calibrate the growth? Whether we will go for a particular type of growth in a particular faster manner. How you will allow the demand to grow so that when the demands actually come up to a particular level, at that time you already have some supply intervention that is available to you. And that establishes a regime of assured, and this also has to be looked at from an assured efficiency level. Demands will be growing. Demands can be made to grow indefinitely. But then that has to be capped by an efficiency. If your efficiency is low and demands are very high, these are not justifiable demands. Because the using the minimum for providing the optimum output is the basic principle of a resource allocation. So efficiency level is inherent into the resource allocation, and that is where the regime of assured efficiency is something that has to be built properly into the policy. And long-term strategic planning, that has to be supported by the policy. That the policy is something which will provide you the directions, as I said earlier in the beginning, that you will have to have, you should be able to learn from that policy that what are the directions in which we should be able to go. And that will provide you with a long-term strategic planning, that what are the plans that we will make in future. So this So this is the area of intrinsic balance of water supply and demand that we are looking at, and there all these areas we need to really look at, that we need to scientifically move in this direction. Water is a physical resource. Water is a resource which is bound by laws of physics. So whenever you want to do something, you have to apply those very principles. Once you have applied those principles and put in putting the systems in place, then the social aspects take over. Then the society will react to those kind of aspects of availability of additional sources, availability of additional opportunities. Then the society will modify its behavior. But inherent things should be scientific. So NWP 2012 looks at water as an independent resource in its own right, required to fulfill the requirements of India. And then the emphasis should be on calculating the rational and growing requirements of Indian population pertaining to sustenance and livelihood needs in the direction of national economic growth based on the principle of equitable distribution. Economic growth is a parasite. Economy grows on resources. Economy grows on capacities. So these economies are something. Water is one of the basic key resource which is required for even your growth. And for that, the rationality in calculating the future requirements and aspirations of the population all come in picture for the principle of equitable distribution. Efficient water supply structures, while implementing optimal or next to optimal demand management strategies, are necessary tools for a sustainably sound system. The implementation can not always be optimal. There are various other pressures and demands and other constraints that will come. So you may have to make some compromises here and there. But then that principle will have to be there. You can't really completely avoid the principle. I am finding some difficulty in moving the from one slide to another. So now various areas are there. If the participants would like, we can have a break of 5 minutes, in which then we can just have some glass of water, and then we can again continue, because this is a pretty long period, 3 hours. It is difficult for me to keep on speaking continuously. So we'll have a break of 5 minutes, and then we'll again resume. Yeah, so now I think we are again good to go. हाँ मैंने इसलिए पूछा था वो जस्ट पूछने के लिए कि वो स्लाइड वगैरह जो चेंज करता हूँ यहाँ पर तो वो तो जरूर है आपके अंकुल ही नहीं रहा। हाँ वो मैंने फिर अभी 5 मिनट का ब्रेक डिक्लेयर किया था बिकॉज इतना कंटिन्यूअस तो वो अभी खारिया का फोन भी Yeah, so now these are the various areas that we need to look at. One is the area of water supply and sanitation, where the provision of safe drinking water for all, commensurate with the safe and effective sewerage management systems, collection and publishing of water accounts, water audit, reports indicating leakages and pilferages. Actually, in case of water supply and sanitation, what we have seen is that the primary issue is that of the distribution and economy. Quantum is not really that great a problem. But the issue is that that particular quantum has to be treated, made to an acceptable quality, and then that quality has to be delivered at your doorstep. This is the part which is really critical. So the water auditing and leakages and pilferages are the ones which are creating the social issues, and that is giving a problem to the drinking water supplies areas. Subsidies and incentives to encourage the recovery of industrial pollutants in recycling and reuse. In the changing urban context where more and more population is going to be becoming urbanized, the recovery of pollutants and recycling and reuse are going to be very important areas in the future. And policy has provided for that in a very systematic manner. If we do not recycle or we do not reuse, then the quantum that is required is so huge that no person in the world can ever provide that much amount of quantum. And then, as I said earlier once, that we are all living downstream of one another. Delhi is downstream of Panipat, and Mathura is downstream of Delhi, and so on and so forth. So this issue of recycling is important, because if I pollute, somebody else will definitely suffer. The various other areas are there, which are also now likely to grow in prominence, like rainwater harvesting and desalinization. But these are very specific areas. This cannot become the solution in a large scale. Like, say, for example, rainwater harvesting. Rainwater harvesting has been in, especially in the drinking water supplies. When you simply look at the rainfalls and you simply multiply them with the area and work out the quantities, then it is very simple to say that you have got all the water that is available to you on your roof itself. But then the fact remains is that when you look at the feasibility of storing that water for you to last the whole year, then you realize that you don't have that much amount of space. So harvesting is good, but harvesting also comes with limits. Desalinization, especially for the drinking water use, is something which is being implemented. With the costs are continuously going down, with the renewable energy coming in picture, desalinization will have a lesser energy footprint also. But still, desalinization of seawater, which is somewhere around 40,000 ppm of soluble metals consideration, is something which is very, very difficult to handle, and it's very costly from the maintenance point of view of the plants. So techno-economical feasibility has to be seen, rather than advertising that as a panacea. Then another area that we can discuss in the water supply and sanitation is the enhancing water available for use, in which, because groundwater is a source which is quite important from the drinking water point of view, you have a situation wherein if the supply sources are not diversified, then you may not be able to meet the demands at all points of time. Now, when you look at the agriculture is able to survive some shortfalls in a manner that is not completely harmful or dangerous to its survival, to its life. But in case of drinking water demands, the dependability has to be very, very high. That is why those of you who are familiar, you realize that when you plan a drinking water project, you actually plan it at 90% dependability. Whereas in case of a water simple irrigation project, the irrigation requirements will be worked out at 75% dependability. So the requirement, the dependability of the requirement, makes the groundwater also as one of the important choices for the drinking water supply and sanitation. Because groundwater has a very long cycle. And there, the issue of aquifer mapping is very much necessary. You may have to reserve some aquifers in order to provide the drinking water supplies. Otherwise, those aquifers, if they get exploited with the agriculture, then your sources will keep on falling off the radar, and you have to continuously keep on finding new sources. Interbasin transfers of water on the basis of merits of each case, after evaluating the environmental, economic, and social impact of such transfers. This is an area which is also now become more important. In fact, this consideration that is on the merits of each case after evaluating environmental, economic and social impacts of such transfers has been used in a negative sense by many people. But we should realize that this particular suggestion was made in 1980, when we had a particular type of demand and particular type of requirements. And today, we are 40 years down the line. A situation is developing where it is no more feasible to augment the supplies by simply using the local water. Whatever is locally available, if you try to use, then the usage will demand certain other areas which will be very difficult to provide for. And the basins have achieved a situation wherein it is no more possible to provide for such kind of supply augmentation, even though you may have physical supplies available. So interbasin transfers are something that in the oncoming policies, we will need to actually say that interbasin transfers are something that the government has to seriously pursue and work for consensus building and providing the real life assessment of the situations in the manner, in a quantitative manner, to show that without these transfers, it will not be feasible for you to really satisfy your demands. Direct use of rainfall, desalinization, avoid of inadvertent evapotranspiration, these are all various other measures that have been recommended, and they are, but the crucial principle is that the planning, development and management of water resources need to be governed by common integrated perspective, considering local, regional, state and national context. At present state of dialogue, what we are finding is that there's a lot of perspective focus on local, regional, and to some extent state. National context is largely being missed in the overall water management scenario. Everybody will basically keep on arguing for their own local areas, and then one is not a kind of a substitute to another. You cannot have only local and you will not have anything national. But then this dialogue has to be set right by the national water policy, that we will have to think on all the contexts. And then having an environmentally sound basis. Environmentally sound basis will also require you to look at a global view of the overall impact. If a particular area undergoing a kind of a deterioration or undergoing some kind of, let us say, submergence or something, will provide benefits and will improve the environment in how much amount of other areas? And then are we having a situation where we can accept that? Integrated watershed development activities from a groundwater perspective with the involvement of local community, this is especially required in those areas which are having over-exploitation. Integrated Water Resources Management, IWRM. This is another very important aspect of our development, which we have, in spite of writing this in our policies and in trying to work towards this, not from now, but from 1956 onwards, we haven't been able to go to the level at which we would like it to go. And that is the problem that is happening at the national level because of the issues of various interstate and other areas. So taking river basin or sub basin as a main unit for planning, development and management of water resources, and for that you may need some amount of restructuring, especially at the state government levels, and made multidisciplinary. This is quite important, because at the state government level, you have a direct interface with the persons who are direct beneficiaries, and there is a lot of political and other interlinkages that are there at that level. So this integrated approach requires a considerable amount of restructuring. And ecological needs of water bodies also to be given priority, because if the natural water bodies, which are also providing you with certain ecosystem services, if you do not look at them, then it becomes a difficult situation. Then the area of water framework law has been put in the national water policy. And the national framework law is an umbrella statement of general principles. Everybody has to agree to some common principles so that you are able to manage a common pool resource. Our common areas of behavior, common areas of acceptable behavior and acceptable priorities will have to be there under this water framework law. Some amount of work has already been done on this water framework law, but even though it will take a long time to come, there are so many issues at the various states level. But overall, like it has been done in case of the European Union and in other places, we also will need to really look at this in future. So that at least when we talk to each other, we talk on certain common principles, we talk on certain common platforms. So water framework law is something that is quite important. Institutional arrangements. We are required to have a national forum to deliberate upon issues relating to water, to evolve consensus, cooperation, and reconciliation amongst party states with a parallel mechanism within the states. This area is also a missing area. We need to have this kind of forum in a coordinated manner. Many times, many of the recent advocacies are also proposing something on the lines of GST Council. There are also others who are proposing that the interstate councils that were there and who are also deliberating on the issues which are between the two states or regions, similar kind of mechanisms will have to be there, where it can act as some kind of a clearing house. And then the disputes can be reduced to the extent possible. And then looking at various other experiences with the Water Disputes Tribunal, the area of Permanent Water Dispute Tribunal to resolve dispute expeditiously is also an area which is under discussion. We already have a bill that is pending in the parliamentary process, and if it comes through, maybe we may have a permanent water disputes tribunal. Very important issue of transboundary rivers. India is in a very, very difficult position, I would say. While we are on one side, we are upper riparians in some parts, we are middle riparians in some other parts. And then there are important, from the strategic and geostrategic point of view, there are important countries and areas who are your lower riparians. So a very tricky balance has to be achieved. And for that, we need to set up international agreements with the neighboring countries. They are very difficult, but they have to be done in a bilateral manner for water sharing, management, and exchange of hydrological data. of rivers, because this hydrological data is not only necessary for the resource availability but also for the disaster management. So transboundary is a tricky issue that we need to settle. And for settling those transboundary issues, we need to have a very good assessment of the parts of the basin that is falling within our own jurisdiction, look at the priorities, what are the priorities that we should be able to achieve, and where we need the cooperation, and how we can mobilize that cooperation from our other countries by providing them with something which they lack. So everybody perceives this as some kind of a win-win situation. Then adaptation to climate change, where we have already discussed about the adaptation strategies against the climate change caused by uncertainties. We will also need in this adaptation to create some kind of an interlinkages between the storages, so that one surplus can be distributed across the places where there may be within the region or within a small geographical area, the shortages may be existing. And these shortages and these surpluses can be adjusted against each other, so that you have a effectively higher water storage for the given number of structures, and you have some kind of carryover storage principle that is possible. And for that, various means will have to be adopted, and these means are all required to be adopted for the climate change adaptation strategies. We'll need to really do a lot of resilience in our planning and management. The storage-based schemes will have to be a part of, integral part of the overall management strategy. So all these areas will go towards the climate change adaptation. Protection of water bodies, drainage channels against encroachments and diversions, and restoring and maintenance mechanisms in existing scenarios, regulatory action against activities causing contamination, pollution. These are all the principles that are already put in the policy, and these principles will have to be converted into strategies, like taking up this protection and regulatory actions. The National Mission on Clean Ganga is trying to do work in this direction. Preparedness for flood and drought and glacial lake outburst or landslides with coping mechanisms, improved forecasting services, improved resilience of the communities, then the dam and embankments, and then if there are any failures, especially the natural dams failures, which also create a kind of a glacial lake and flash floods in the hilly regions, and it creates a huge amount of costly infrastructure damages or loss of lives. Then comes the capacity building. We need to have good database and information systems. If you do not have an informed argument, then you have a tendency of getting swayed by extremes. And those extremes then lead to a non-optimal or at times damaging kind of policy or strategic choices. So informed dialogue in water resources is something of a must. In fact, we have the very big problem of taking in a large number of people across the board into this dialogue by having an unambiguous data and demonstrating out of the data the basis of the policy or basis of the interventions that we are taking. There is a lot of work that we did in as a part of the India Waris. And now that it has gone and established a National Water Informatics Center, which of course requires certain further improvements to be done, but then it has to be directed in that line, and we need to have standardized integrated databases with well-defined procedures and formats. The formats are very important in databases. If you have data but it is not in the format that can be consumed, then that data will not carry as much value. So what kind of formats are needed for water management areas are also something that we need to decide and then try to collect the data. The research centers for evaluating the impact of various other areas, water has a very wide research footprint. If you look at the water, you go into the technologies, you go into the social aspects, you go into the management aspects, you go into the financial aspects, and then within this itself, you have got so many other areas. Because if you simply take the technology, then in the technology, you land up in areas which are highly specified, highly specific in the material sciences, which are highly specific in the say hydraulics, which are highly specific in hydrology, and so on and so forth. If you go to, let's say, finance, again, same kind of situation occurs because the amount of demand for finance is so large. Public finance, how do you mobilize that finance? What are the models for mobilizing that finance, and so on and so forth. So what water has a very large footprint, and many of such areas are such that which are specific to water. Take this simple example, which you know I am familiar with this. You take the case of, say, alkali-silica reaction in concrete dams. Now, a very specific thing. But then that is something, this particular phenomena, if you do not have good research on that, you really have a problem in maintaining and managing those dams. And then it ultimately results in a very great problem. And research in that will have to be carried out by somebody who is interested in dams and who is interested in water resources. Because normal buildings may not have that kind of a problem of that particular nature. So these issues like this, there are very specific issues which needs focused research. And for that, we need a very strong autonomous research centers who are able to look into these areas and evaluate the impacts. We also need research in the areas of policy. What are the kind of directives that we did? What are the kind of interventions that are happening? What are the lacunae in that interventions? And what way this lacunae can be rectified? This is the experience through which we have to learn. And for that, the research is needed. However, we are having certain amount of constraints in the present day scenario where our research is not at the level at which we would like to have. But still, policy says that we need to have a very strong research and training needs, because what we develop out of the research has to be translated into action through the extensive training areas. And then the implementation, the standard implementation procedure is the National Water Board, National Water Resources Council. And then there is a regularly monitor its implementation. This is a biggest lacuna in all our policies. The implementation of the policy, we haven't been able to really provide the kind of directions and the kind of inputs that we should have been providing. We are all, there is a lot of lip service to the policy, but the problem is that the regular implementation is an area which requires a serious thought, and where our governance and our collaborative principles, etc., will all come in picture. And state governments also need to revise their policy. Some of the state governments have already revised, and some of the state governments are still in the process of revising. There's a lot of confusion on this part. But we need to have a very strong national dialogue and then come up with something which is acceptable to all. So these are the challenges that we are facing in the implementation, state and center coordination and cooperation. There are conflicting demands of different states and different areas of interests, monitoring and evaluation. At the central level, we need to have a direct feel. When you are writing national water policy, you need to have a kind of a first-hand feel. And the first-hand feel is something which is very difficult to come by, because we are an indirect partner. We are merely at the central level, we are only facilitator. The implementer is somewhere else. So monitoring and evaluation. And that will then provide you with the nudge behavior, that what kind of nudging this is all these areas are very having their very large momentum. Today, you simply can't go to a particular state and say that don't do this, and see the kind of backlash. We are already seeing this backlash in the recent, say, farm laws. Even though they are towards a great amount of benefit to the people concerned, even then, there are pockets which will say that, well, I don't like it. So the social behaviors and these behaviors have to be nudged into the place. They cannot be forced into the place. They cannot be hammered into the place. And this nudge behavior has to be generated out of all these experiences and sharing of the knowledges. These are the areas like, say, Water Resource Association and PIM. We are struggling with it since long time. Water pricing, everybody knows. We have a serious problem on water pricing. And unless you build an economic basis to the water distribution, the water distribution investments will always lack. Groundwater management, we know that there are serious issues with the groundwater management. Floodplains is a yearly occurrence. Every year, larger number of people will say we have all got flooded. But then when it comes to investigating, you realize that many of the people are such that they should not have been there in the first place, because the government never told them not to be there. Because you never did any floodplain zoning and encroachments were never prevented. So all these areas ultimately need development of a strategy which will follow the policy, and then that strategy will have to be implemented through an action plan. We have been at the policy level, and these two levels are as yet unexplored, and we are of course again in another step of going in for and writing new policy. We can keep on writing the policies, but at least whatever you have to really seriously implement it, and you have to really seriously think about it. So thank you very much. I think I covered a lot today, and we had a lot of thoughts being thrown about. So now we can have discussions, and we can see what we are able to achieve out of this. So I think there are
now there is a question answer session. If participants have any doubts, queries, questions, kindly freely ask. Kindly ask if any doubts, any questions. If you want, you also write in chat box. We will answer.
Yeah, I have kept my chat box open, so I will be able to read whatever questions are being asked. So maybe I have put everybody of you in a stupor with too much amount of speaking, or what?
Nobody is having any doubt or please, sir.
Well, that's a sense of achievement that you spoke so much. Yes. That everybody had all their doubts cleared while speaking itself. But
yes, sir.
All the same, it is good to have some questions. So if there are any questions, we can still go one more round and see if anybody would like to ask any questions.
May I come in, sir?
Yeah, Bhopal Singh, go ahead.
Thank you, sir. So just I wanted to know, sir, basically at present there is no mechanism for capturing how much water we are using in each basin or each. What is the basically methodology adopted in various other countries? Because we don't have even the framework for capturing the data as such. What should be done in this direction, sir?
Actually, looking at our position in our country, we will need to go for some kind of an indirect assessment. it is very difficult for us to go for direct assessment in the view of the fact that we are not having any agencies who would be able to provide you with the monitoring at the outlet level in the irrigation. So we will need to go for some kind of indirect manner, like these you know, remote sensing approaches and all, to look at the overall water utilization. And then from there, we will need to develop some kind of correlation, so that we can then say that actual water utilization is so much. Because as you know, the interstate dialogues are such that the provision of data in an unbiased manner is very difficult to have.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there is one question.
Yeah.
This is Akkala Devi Rama, Rama Babu. Are there any national water policy 2012? If so, any new policy proposed soon?
Well, a policy is already under development, even though it has got its own problems. But as I understand, the policy is something which has been there since 1986, and more or less we are having the same priorities in the successive policies, even though they are getting expanded in a different manner. So policy wise new policy is in the line, and I don't know what way it will come out, because that is still under discussion.
Thank you, sir. Next question, has central government any policies about flood protection in the interest of states?
Central government has already provided with a model flood zoning bill, and central government has also provided with interstate context flood forecasting services. And for those managing those services and maintaining those services, already the central government is working on that. So now the onus is largely on the state governments for utilizing and for strengthening those policies.
Sir, the next question is from Mr. Vijay. He is asking, water is a state subject. How effective would be these national policies?
Well, this is a slight amount of a misconception. While water is a state subject, but it is governed also by the Entry 56. The large part of the waters are all interstate waters. And those interstate waters will necessarily have to be adjudicated at the central level. So as a country, you do have an interest, because when you use water, you are taking it out of somebody else's share. Water is not something which is a localized resource like coal or petroleum. So there is, all these areas require the national government to be part of the water dialogue and water policy.
Thank you, sir. Any more questions, please? I think, sir, more questions.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Friends, one announcement. Our session will be on 9th November 2020. The topic will be Interstate River Water Dispute Tribunals, and the available speaker will be Sri Chetan Pandit, sir. He is a former member Central Water Commission. Okay, friends, now we will meet on 9th November at sharp 11 o'clock for the subject Interstate River Water Dispute Tribunal. Thank you, friends. Okay, good day. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.